Now, welcome to part two of this four-part series of the in-depth understanding and the hidden equipment you find on the Latitude. And this part discusses the Tilcon area with some extra information about the fairing fence and the MPU intakes and exhausts. So let's start out with the fairing fence under the belly of the aircraft. And there are two of them on this side of the aircraft, and they are venting the hydraulic equipment under the belly. Now here is the ram air inlet to provide cooling between the hot air, the hot bleed air, when anti-ice is being used, and the fuel tanks. In this picture, you can see the ram air goes into the heat shield, and it will exit on the outer edge of the wing under what they call louvers. Here is a picture of the fuel tank vent inlet scoop and the tank pressure relief valve. And the relief valve is there in a rare case that the fuel tank vent inlet scoop gets blocked due to ice or anything. If that happens and you start a descent, you actually get up in a scenario where the whole wing can collapse. So this way it actually prevents the collapsing. This is the toilet servicing panel. So once you open this panel, it starts a timer of 15 minutes and you're able to empty and refill the toilet. After those 15 minutes, you cannot empty the toilet anymore as the inner bung valve remains shut. You can also notice by looking at the green LED light. A green LED light means 5-6 liters are in there. And when the green light turns off, that means the 15 minutes are up. So you cannot refill or do anything with the toilet service anymore. The red LED light, that means it's overfilled or the filter's blocked. In our case, most of the time, it's when the filter is blocked. If that is the case, you want to clean the filter by holding the push to flush button in the toilet, so toilet service can automatically fill the toilet. Then flush it, and that's a couple of times, and empty it again. If that does not work or solve the problem, you can also use hot water. Don't use the boiling water that might melt the plastic inside, just use hot water. Also, a good idea is to brief the passengers about the toilet bin location, so they do not throw away any towels or even diapers that we found in the toilet. That definitely blocks the filter. If you cannot fill the toilet with toilet fluid, pressing the flush button will override the system so you can fill the toilet. Now, you do not need to turn the batteries on for this. You just, with the batteries off, push the flush button, it will fill. Again, this flush button only works for 15 minutes when the panel is open. Here's the ground service panel for your hydraulics. This is a maintenance panel officially. It's not part of the walkaround, but I thought that's, I'll show you anyway. This is the ram air intake for the Tilcon area with the fluid diverters. If you look at this picture, the lower open yellow pipe inside the Tilcon is the outlet of this ram air. There is no filter inside, only a wire mesh blocking the bigger insects. So keep in mind, smaller insects can actually enter the Tilcon, so don't be stung by mosquitoes. If you look up from this area, you see the pre-cooler. Here a picture of how it looks like from the inside without covers. And behind the pre-cooler are the fuel lines, as you can see here. Here are the engine drains. There are 8 of them. Then the alternator exhaust and the generator exhaust. And below the engine, you have the generator intake. Here a picture of the engine without cowling. And let's enter the Tilcon and let me explain what we will find here. One of the first things you want to do is turn on the light. Here's the switch. And on the same panel you find an APU emergency stop button. All the way in the back, behind the baggage compartment, there is your inverter for the coffee machine. It is accessible through the baggage compartment itself, where you can unscrew a side panel and open it up so you can reach this inverter. In some of the newer aircraft, the GoGo entertainment box is also located here. It's in front of the coffee machine inverter. And below here is the pipe of the Tilcon RAM air intake, as I showed you before. Now on top of the baggage compartment, you see the engine bleed air entrance that goes through the ozone filter here and down towards the temperature controllers here. Now, these two pipes run below the baggage compartment, meaning that even though this compartment is not heated or pressurized from the inside, it does heat a bit on the bottom due to these pipes. So in case you have toothpaste or other stuff that might freeze up in long flights when you're flying quite high, it is worth knowing that you can place your suitcase such that you put the liquids on the low side that is actually touching the lower part of the baggage compartment. This way, actually, your luggage and your liquids remain warm and will not freeze up. All right, here's the baggage compartment exhaust. As you can already see here, it is a one-way pipe. And in the pipe, there is a fire arrester, as I talked about before, to keep the fire contained in the baggage compartment. Now here are your two engine fire bottles, and this golden box here is an inverter for your horizontal stabilized trim. It is called the ACU, or actuator control unit. Reset button on the back of this golden box often clears a primary step trim fill cast message, in case you have it. And it seems to work most of the time if you reset it. And the orange box is your FA2100 flight data recorder. And on the right are your two big HF couplers. It's called the KAC1052 if you're interested. Now sometimes you get a GTC message in the cockpit stating HF1 antenna coupler pressure warning. You might have seen it already. And this means that the internal nitrogen pressure is low. Now the coupler itself is a sealed unit that tunes the HF antenna and then sends a high wattage radio frequency transmission. And it's quite a lot of power, so it can be quite dangerous if it shorts. Now, it uses nitrogen to purge air from inside the coupler case to eliminate arcing at altitude. Now, the case is pressurized to eliminate moisture intrusion, again to prevent arcing and to prevent short circuits. With this low pressure warning, if it's there, it actually disables the associated HF, but just to make sure it is by no means a groundable item. Also, often when you're airborne with this message, you can expect the message to clear because the lower outside pressure will actually make the residual pressure inside this coupler enough to make the coupler work again. Now, the air cycle machine is right on top of you when you enter the tailcone. I'll talk about it later. And the HCM exhaust pipe, as you can see here, goes to the back of the aircraft and exits to the left of the back. Now, if it rains, and especially when the wind is hitting this ACM exhaust pipe and enters this exhaust pipe, it can accumulate in the pipe and drip water onto the Tilcon entrance door. So it is a good idea to open up the door after it has rained to drain the water. That said, the newer models actually have a drain line connected here, so this is less of a problem, as you can see here. All right, further back you have the APU and the rudder and stabilizer controls. Now you can pause the video here to check all the items out. As you might remember, the left yoke connects to the ailerons and the left elevator, while the right yoke connects to the three middle spoilers and the right elevator. So as you can see in this picture, the yaw damper is connected to an assembly where the elevator control and the rudder control are coming together. Right here, a picture of the APU I took in Wichita. Here you can see all the intakes and exhausts of the APU. It's actually quite a simple system where it has a single centrifugal compressor and a single centrifugal turbine that runs it all. Now let's continue, and here you see the APU fire extinguishing line. Now many aircraft have a small opening in this pipe, making it possible to also extinguish the tail cone a bit if activated. Now, as you know, there's no way to normally activate extinguishing inside the tail cone, so this way, if you actually use the APU fire extinguisher, it does create a little bit of extinguishing inside the tail cone. Now here you see such an opening in this pipe. Now keep in mind, not all aircraft have this opening, so it's not guaranteed. This is the APU baggage fire extinguisher. It auto-extinguishes the APU if fire is detected with an 8-second delay. I said earlier, it will actually not auto-extinguish the baggage compartment if you have a fire there. The white push-to-test button on the bottle is to check the temperature compensated pressure switch. And this switch senses bottle pressure and sends a signal if the bottle is empty. There's no other way to actually get a message or information about the bottle pressure. It's just cast message being empty or not. Now with this push to test, just to make sure, do not test this. This is a maintenance item. Above the APU fire extinguisher is the KRX 1053 HF receiver and exciter. To the left of it is the KPA 1052 HF power amplifier, in case you're interested. It's all LIUs, basically to make the HF system work. And as I said before, you're right under the air cycle machine. So let me show you a picture of how that looks like if you're looking from the bottom up to the tail cone. And here a bare bone picture of the air cycle machine itself. All right, that completes the tail cone, and let's continue. And when you're back outside, it is time to check all the intakes and exhausts on the tail side of the ladder jet. Now here a picture of what each intake and exhaust is. Right, we continue, we get the APU exhaust. And here we got a maintenance access panel for the APU bay area. Now we can check the oil level here. If it's on the lower dot, it's the minimum, and on the top dot is the maximum fill level. Again, this is a maintenance panel, something you do not have to do for the walkaround. And we continue to the drains of the APU. Four drains of the APU. Now here we have the RAM intake of the APU bay area. Alright, and that completes the second part of this four-part series of in-depth understanding and the hidden equipment you'll find on a leather jet aircraft.